who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land.
Disneyland and Disney's California Adventure, along with the Disneyland Hotel, Paradise Pier, Disney's Grand Californian, and Downtown Disney, make up the over 100 acres known as the Disneyland Resort. Over the years, it has brought joy and entertainment to millions. Hard to believe it all started over half a century ago as one man's dream. This man, Walt Disney. He was a storyteller and an innovator, looking to create something special, something magical for his daughters.
Well, it came about when my daughters were very young, and Saturday was always Daddy's Day. I took them different places, and as I'd sit there while they rode the merry-go-round, did all these things, I felt that there should be something built where that the parents and the children could have fun together. So that's how Disneyland started. A daddy with two daughters wondering where he could take them, where he could have a little fun with them too.
And with that spark of inspiration to guide him, Walt began to assemble a team who could bring his dream to reality. He enlisted a unique gathering of talent, combining the skills and experience of artisans, carpenters, engineers, scientists, and planners who could creatively blend imagination with technical know-how. He called them Imagineers. Hi, I'm Dave Fisher, an Imagineer here at Walt Disney Imagineering Headquarters in Glendale, California. Disneyland, Imagineering the Magic, is really our story. So what is Imagineering? Well, who better to tell that story than someone who is here almost from the beginning, Imagineering Ambassador Marty Sklar.
Hi, I'm Marty. I'm Executive Vice President and Imagineering Ambassador for Parks and Resorts. Imagineering is the blending of creative imagination with technical know-how, which Walt Disney set up in 1952 to work with him creating and designing Disneyland. I don't think he really knew exactly how he was going to proceed once he made the decision to do Disneyland. And I know he went to his friend Welton Becket, an architect. Mr. Becket asked the right question. He said, "What is it?" And it might have been the first time that Walt had to describe to somebody outside the company what he wanted to do. Mr. Becket gave him some really good advice. He said, "You know, Walt, you're going to use architects, you're going to use engineers, but you're going to have to train your own people because it's storytelling and they understand what you want to do." Herb Ryman loved telling this story about getting a call from Walt in the fall of 1953. And Walt saying, "Herbie, Roy Sr., Walt's brother, has to take the drawings of Disneyland to New York to show the bankers on Monday." And Herbie said, "Great, I'd love to see them." And Walt said, no, you don't understand, you're going to do them." And Herbie said, "I don't know what to draw." And Walt said, "I'll tell you what to draw." And literally stood at Herbie's shoulder for the weekend, and what was produced was the first overall rendering of Disneyland.
Disneyland was based on the movies, the stories that Walt and his staff had created, the things that Walt was interested in. Main Street, based on the nostalgic movies, Adventureland on the true life adventures, Fantasyland, obviously on the animated features, Frontierland on the westerns and Zorro and all the things he created, and Tomorrowland on his futuristic shows on the Disneyland television show about looking to tomorrow. What's interesting is that those themes that Walt created for Disneyland in 1955 work so well today that most stories that we want to put in the park, you very quickly can figure out where they would go in the park and how to fit them in there. And it's brilliant.
Walt wanted a way to separate the outside world from the world he was creating inside Disneyland.
Obviously, he was thinking about this for a long time. He was an incredibly creative and innovative dreamer, but he also had the team that could make it reality. It's fascinating today to see how that dream lives on.
Disneyland is your land. Here age relives fond memories of the past, and here youth may savor the challenge and promise of the future.
I don't want the public to see the world they live in while they're in the park, Walt told his Imagineers. I want them to feel they're in another world. Here you leave today and enter the world of yesterday, tomorrow, and fantasy. Let's go see the world they created for us to enjoy.
Disneyland is dedicated to the ideals, the dreams, and the hard facts that have created America, with the hope that it will be a source of joy and inspiration to all the world.
Welcome to Main Street USA, a nostalgic trip through small town America.
Disneyland is a reflection of, I think, popular cultural icons and myths. Directors and producers of Walt's era saw the Victorian time in America, the gaslight giving way to electricity, as being kind of that quintessential wonder moment when America was changing and it was new and it was fresh. It works really well to see this kind of Valentine to a world in America that is no longer there.
One thing about the buildings on Main Street, they don't compete with one another. Walt wanted to show how there weren't contradictions of one style of architecture fighting with another style. For Walt Disney, Main Street was a real town. You know, in Main Street, Walt wanted to go back to a time he remembered fondly.
He spent about 5 years in a little town called Marceline in the Midwest. Marceline really crystallized in Walt that kind of home spirit that he wasn't able to have much beyond that.
Trains were obviously a very important piece of Disneyland to Walt. In fact, more than that, a very important piece of his life. The trains ran past their farmhouse in Marceline, and later on he sold newspapers on trains and of course came to Los Angeles from Kansas City on a train. His hobby, it turned out, was he was going to build a scale locomotive.
Not a full-size train, but a little train, which he called Lilybell in honor of his wife, that ran all around their property up in Hollenby Hills. Now, when people would come over to ride this, it had a capacity of like 4 or 5, and I think the number one comment was, Walt, you've got to create something that's bigger that can handle all of your guests. And you know, I think a lot of that plays back into what eventually became Disneyland.
Hey, Mickey, can I get a ride? Here's Marty to let you in on the secrets of the fire station.
Over the fire station, of course, is an apartment that was used by Walt and Mrs. Disney.
But one of the most unique things, there was a hole in the floor under the carpet that went directly into the fire station below. And Walt would actually use that fire pole. He was so eager to get out in the park, so he would just go down the fire pole. Well, some enterprising guests tried just the opposite and shimmied up the fire pole and pushed the lid open, and there they were in Walt's apartment. So from that day forward, that has kind of been boarded up.
The Opera House also has a great story to tell.
The Opera House, though, was really a facade when Disneyland opened, because it was used originally as the mill to do a lot of the woodwork for Disneyland. Finally, in the mid-60s, a theater was built in the Opera House to hold great moments with Mr. Lincoln.
Probably the most lasting development in terms of show-telling techniques was the creation of audio animatronics. And the most stunning application was the Lincoln Show. Mr. Lincoln had to stand on the stage with no distractions and captivate an audience for about 10 minutes.
One day, Walt came in and said, Blaine, you're going to be my sculptor for Disneyland.
Our sculptor, Blaine Gibson, has been able to create this very accurate likeness of this great man.
Because he'd seen some small pieces that Blaine had done at the studio, his instructions from Walt was, I want these audio animatronic figures to be real.
And Walt said, you know, because the focus is on that one face for the entire show, I want the animation to be so well done that you can read the lips.
Wayful Rogers wore the harness that they used to use to program the figures, and he's all bound up in this contraption, and when he turns his head, the figure turns his head. He developed, you know, a lot of the techniques that we learned to use.
I think Wathel was the real father of audio animatronics. Wathel worked on all the original figures and was involved in the programming. Well, the windows on Main Street have the names of the people that really helped Walt to create Disneyland.
Walt had to figure out a way to reward some of the people that he really felt had gone above and beyond the board.
He wanted to honor them and thank them. And so you'll see Plaza School of Art with Herb Ryman and John Hinch and Peter Ellenshaw and Dick Irvine and Bill Cottrell and people who contributed to the creation of Disneyland. It became a tradition.
Welcome to Central Plaza. It's also known as the Hub because of the five original theme lands that radiate off it like the spokes of a wheel.
That hub allows you to get back to, you know, knowing where you are. You never get lost in the park. You can always meet your friends and family easily. It's just so brilliant.
The bronze statue of Walt Disney and Mickey Mouse here in the Hub is called Partners. Sculpted by Imagineer Blaine Gibson, it's a tribute to Disneyland's founder and his most famous creation.
Within Adventureland is a wonder world of nature's own design. Her animal creatures, her fabulous plan of life.
Welcome to Adventureland, a thrilling journey to exotic and enchanting realms of exploration, adventure, and discovery, inspired in part by Walt Disney's True Life Adventure series of films. What's the matter, Donald? You look lost. Well, while we're trying to figure out your map, let's let the Imagineers take us on a safari through Adventureland.
Adventureland came out of the True Life Adventures.
Walt had a tremendous series in the 50s called the True Life Adventures, and they won many Academy Awards. And it was a natural to develop a place that took people to every corner of Exotica around the world.
Harper Goff was the designer of the Jungle Cruise, and I think the original idea was to go in some kind of what we'd call four-wheel drive vehicle today. But that became so impractical. Fortunately, the African Queen movie came out, and that became an inspiration, put people in boats.
And so Harper was enamored with this film and said, hey, Walt, why don't we do something to do with cruising on a jungle boat?
When the Jungle Cruise opened, it had that type of a boat in a world that was right out of Walt's True Life Adventures, and it was very realistic.
You know, originally he wanted to put live animals there. So the idea was you would go off on an adventure in this jungle boat and see live animals on the shore. But he finally met with some animal experts who said, you know, the problem with putting live animals there is it's not always going to work out for you. And Walt, being the showman that he was, he wanted these things to be staged perfectly. And so they decided to create mechanical animals that they could stage exactly the way he wanted them staged.
Now, as the years went by, they looked for ways in which to make it more entertaining and more fun to go back over and over again, because Disneyland is all about riding things over and over again.
So Mark Davis went down to the park and he rode the Jungle Cruise attraction, and he said, you know, one thing you guys are missing from this is humor, is comedy. There's a lot of opportunity.
Mark knew how to draw in such a way that you could absolutely understand the storytelling by just looking at a drawing.
When Mark told Walt that he thought there should be more humor in the park, well, I think Mark did some really brilliant things. They're really the images that you remember more than anything out of the Jungle Cruise.
Come to the tiki room. Hurry to the tiki room.
Well, the Enchanted Tiki Room originally was a restaurant.
Walt had envisioned this idea of a special room in the back of that restaurant where you could go in and start to have a wonderful kind of Polynesian meal. And midway through the dinner, all of a sudden, everything in the room would come to life.
So they had been playing with the development of a bird, a parrot.
Well, it was the introduction of what we now call audio animatronics, but this is the first time anyone had seen birds and flowers and tiki gods all talk and sing in perfect synchronization with the music and story.
the idea of the birds talking and singing got so interesting to Walt that he said, you know what? I don't think this should be just a restaurant. This ought to be a show. And so the Tiki Room took off as a development.
We have four macaws who act as master ceremonies in the Tiki Bird Room, Disneyland. And they actually keep the show rolling. And along with them are other birds who sing and things, and flowers that sing. And then the tiki images, you know, the carved tiki poles and things with these tiki gods, they sing and they drum, and we have quite a show.
Now, friends, before we see the show, I take you behind the scene for a few moments.
The idea of the restaurant was abandoned, and it was now made into about a 15-minute show. And he brought the people back in and said, okay, what do you think of it now that it's a show? And they said, we still don't know what it is. Nothing like this has ever been seen before. So he brought in Dick and Robert Sherman.
So Bob and Dick came in and wrote in the Tiki, 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 Tiki Room.
What is the Tiki Room? It's a place where all the birds sing words and the flowers bloom in the Tiki, 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 Tiki Room. And that opens the show.
What about you, Jose? You got anything to say?
Hasta la vista.
That's right, hasta la vista.
We had the opportunity to work with George Lucas on Indiana Jones, and we were able to take the basis of that story and use it for a moving simulator and take you on a ride in, through Indiana Jones' adventures.
I think nothing beats what we call our enhanced motion vehicle, and it can literally react to all these incoming special effects. So imagine if you're in a world like that and a giant snake comes out to you and the car recoils in horror. We had to mock that up. Well, the darn thing was so much fun, and that was the launching for bringing to life this Indiana Jones experience where we had to create a ride vehicle that you never know what this thing's gonna do. You're on edge the whole time because it's capable of doing anything.
Tony would spend all his spare time going to different attractions and figuring out how they worked and why and how people related to them.
And one of the things I pride myself in doing is whenever I'm out visiting anything that can be as amazing as a World's Fair or as simple as going to a high school play, I'm always looking at it in a backwards way. And I think Indy has a great example of that because our big finale came from a humble drive-through car wash. Now, you've probably all been in those things where you drive in and then you put it into neutral. And the first thing you do is look down because it gives your brain the effect that the car is drifting through the machine. And I wrote that down. I said, we got to use this. Well, at the end of the ride, we knew we couldn't have people go rushing towards a raging boulder. So we let the brain do the trick. And we moved the entire room, just like the car wash, while Indy's yelling, back up, back up. If you didn't have it in your brain automatically, Indy has planted it in there with that word, and everybody believes fully that we're engaged in backing up at that point. And what we're doing is we're just kind of creeping you forward. And at the last minute, we just drop you down, and that's the end of the ride.
Frontierland. It is here that we experience the story of our country's past. The color, romance, and drama of frontier America.
Frontierland is a return to the heritage of the Old West and the spirit of the pioneers who blazed trails across America. Goofy, I think the cue for Big Thunder Mountain Railroad is right down there. While Goofy's going to catch the next train, let's listen to the Imagineers spin a few yarns about the creation of Frontierland.
The largest land in all of Disneyland is Frontierland. Walt Disney had a whole bunch of series on national television all about the American West.
Now in our TV series from Frontierland, we're going to tell about these real people who became legend, like Davy Crockett.
The success of Davy Crockett at the time Disneyland was being designed influenced Frontierland more than anything else. You know, it was also a way of preserving our heritage.
This was a place where all these stories about America's heritage could come to life.
In the very beginning of Disneyland, there was a stagecoach. There was a mule ride, and there were Conestoga wagons. Walt started thinking about new things that could go in there, and the first one was an area called Nature's Wonderland, and there was a train ride.
which was, again, based on a lot of the true life adventures like Vanishing Prairie. It brought to life all the animals of America's West.
But as change came about and the opportunity to come up with a new idea developed, and when Tony Baxter brought this concept for a runaway train, that was a very exciting potential.
I was asked to look into converting the train ride, the mine train ride that was there, into a little bit more exciting version of a mine train. And we had been toying around with something we called Thunder Mesa.
So he created a model, a ride where he used a marble as the vehicle, showed how it would go through the whole series of things. That became the Big Thunder Mountain Railroad.
I opened a National Geographic, and it said in the first paragraph, "When you see Bryce Canyon for the first time, you'll think this is a creation out of the world of Walt Disney." You know, so there it was. That was our inspiration. And that became Big Thunder Mountain, which opened in 1979. When we created Big Thunder Mountain, it was important to leave certain things that were a part of Disneyland's historical past. So we had a little village, the mining town of Rainbow Ridge, and we worked really diligently to make sure that Rainbow Ridge had a place in the new show. So when you come out to the park today, you'll see that the whole ride concludes in the little village that was there since the days of Walt.
This is Critter Country, a down-home, backwoods setting for Splash Mountain and the 100-acre wood. Pluto, do you know the story behind Critter Country? No? Well then, get ready for a couple of Imagineering tall tales.
In the early years of Disneyland, there was an Indian village where Native Americans came out and performed their dances, and there was a whole lot of cultural elements there. And Mark Davis had, you know, created a fabulous attraction called Country Bear Jamboree. It was an obvious addition to Disneyland, so the Indian village gave way to Bear Country. And Bear Country was the place where the Country Bear Jamboree set up shop.
Yeah, one of the last things that Mark Davis had the opportunity to show Walt Disney was some sketches of bears. And he had the idea of the bears playing musical instruments. And Walt really loved the sketches that he saw.
Mark Davis, he was instrumental in the designs and the drawings of the original Country Bear Jamboree. And there was another fellow, Albertino, who was the model for Big Al. He was Big Al. And I met him many years later, and I was astounded that he looks just like Big Al. Maybe not as much fur, but certainly his attitude and his face is just wonderful. And apparently he's the first man who sang Blood on the Saddle for Walt and sold the idea.
The characters were very cartoony and very fun, and Big Al is probably, people still remember Big Al singing Blood on the Saddle.
Dick Nunes, who was the president of Disneyland, had been very interested in getting a flume ride. Well, I felt if Disney's going to do a flume ride, we have to have a story that is really unique.
One day, Tony Baxter was driving on the freeway, and he had an idea for what to do with all those characters that were in America Sings.
And I thought about Br'er Rabbit and Br'er Bear and Br'er Fox, and America Sings had run its course. I couldn't see destroying all those figures. So by the time I'd gotten up my hour drive on the Santa Ana Freeway, I walked into the group of people that were working with me in the design department. I said, what about this? We use all the characters that are gonna be scrapped from America Sings. So by the end of that day, we had a program, and it ultimately became Splash Mountain. Now, the name Splash Mountain seems like a natural, but it's really funny how it happened, because it was originally called the Zippity River Run. Disney at the same time was coming out with Splash with Daryl Hannah as a mermaid. And the executives at the studio were really excited about this very big hit. And they came over and saw our ideas and badgered us. Well, can you put the mermaid in there? Because it's water and this is a water ride and that would be really cool. And I said, no, because she doesn't fit with Br'er Rabbit and Br'er Bear and the characters of the South, you know. They said, well, at least then use the name, Splash Mountain. That sounds really good. Well, at the time, we couldn't see that because Splash, the movie, was nothing like this little ride with Zippity Doodah and everything. But it's interesting because as time has gone on, Splash Mountain is the perfect name and perfectly describes that attraction.
As new ideas come about, Country Bears became Critter Country and Splash Mountain came in. And then there was a real drive to try to get more recent Disney characters into the park. So Tony Baxter created a Winnie the Pooh attraction in the space that once was the Country Bear Jamboree Theater.
This is what we call New Orleans Square. All these little streets are going to be very intriguing, little shops and things.
New Orleans Square is a tribute to the French Quarter with its special culinary delicacies. It's also home to rollicking pirates, grim grinning ghosts, and Dixieland jazz. Oh, and this place, Club 33. Thanks, Mickey. Just down the boulevard from Pirates of the Caribbean. Now we're doing lunch, right?
Well, very few people get to see the area above Pirates of the Caribbean and the Blue Bayou, but it's riddled with all kinds of chambers and rooms.
Walt had, of course, used his apartment over the fire station on Main Street, but as his family grew and he had more grandchildren, he decided he needed a bigger place. And as New Orleans Square was being developed, he was going to build an apartment on the second floor of New Orleans Square.
Now, on the other side is Club 33.
Actually, it came about because at the New York World's Fair, all the companies had their own private clubs in their pavilions. So Walt decided to build a private club.
So Club 33 was invented as this kind of private retreat so that all of his partners in Disneyland could come up there and be treated really royally. And it's still in operation today for mostly the same reasons.
There are a number of illustrations in Club 33 that were done by Mark Davis and by Herb Ryman. And those are the major pieces that are there as atmosphere in the club.
Now, there's a lot of rumors as to why it was called the Club 33. One was that there were 33 corporations that Walt was going after in creating Disneyland and the World's Fair, but we happen to know that there's so many more that 33 couldn't have possibly been related to that.
Club 33 was named after 33 Royal Street, which is
just the address of the building.
Walt had decided he was going to do a walkthrough of a pirate story, and actually the steel was put in the ground in that area. And then the New York World's Fair came along.
The New York World's Fair gave Walt and his Imagineers a great opportunity to invent ride systems that could move people in innovative ways through attractions.
One of the developments was the water cruise for It's a Small World, which allowed us to take 3,000 people an hour through the attraction. So when we came back from the fair, Walt said, we can't do this a walkthrough. Let's do the pirate idea as a water ride. And that's when Mark started doing those drawings.
Now these sketches here have to do with some of the things that are going to happen when you take this cruise through the pirate's domain.
Way before I worked at Imagineering, Pirates of the Caribbean was under construction. I always was snooping around, and I decided I would open one of the doors that came out in what would soon be the Pirates of the Caribbean. And I peeked around the corner, and a voice said, well, you can't see anything from there. You've got to get down in here to really understand it and see it. And for the first time, I could see boats moving through. And there was a man on the dock, and I said, is there any chance that an ice cream scooper could go on and be human ballast on this thing, because they had sandbags in there? He goes, yeah, sure, jump in. And for an hour, I was lost in a world of enchantment down there. The guy that was taking me through turned out to be, ultimately, 10 years later, my mentor, Claude Coates.
And Claude is the Imagineer in charge of the pirate project.
Claude's work was really laying out the attraction and taking the character drawings that Mark Davis did on the Pirates of the Caribbean and laying out the scenes where the characters would react and providing the background settings for the action.
The phenomenon that resulted in the first Pirates of the Caribbean film came back to us, of course, and they had based the film on our Pirates of the Caribbean ride. The ride had been running the same way, with minor enhancements throughout the years. Now there are children who see the movie first and then the ride. And they're gonna say, I don't understand why the people from the movie aren't in this ride if they made this ride about the movie.
We actually, as Imagineers, you know, we're always looking at ways of giving all of our attractions a new, fresh look. And we actually had been working on ideas of what are some of the things that we can do to bring new technology, new magic into our classics.
We figured out a way to bring in the Captain Jack Sparrow figure and the Barbossa figure into the ride. The whole idea was they were always there. The ride should look like they were always there and they were meant to be there. So we didn't take any scenes out, we sort of inserted them.
The writers for the film did such an incredible job of taking the essence of the Pirates attraction and bringing that into the movie so seamlessly that it was very natural that Captain Jack Sparrow and Barbossa really were sort of born out of the attraction, that they sort of seamlessly belonged in there.
The two different modes of entertainment have to live together. And it was a really interesting problem. I say interesting, it was agony to try to get this right, because we did not want the original inspiration to be changed.
The entire team was very aware of the value of that attraction, and our goal was always to enhance the classic and not change it. And I think we were very successful in bringing Barbossa and Captain Jack into the attraction.
Goblins and ghoulies from last Halloween. Awaken the spirits with your tambourine.
Well, there had been many stories developed about a haunted house, and there was a lot of discussion about whether it should look like it was falling apart. But Walt said that we're going to build a home for retired ghosts. We'll take care of the outside, and we'll let the ghosts take care of the inside.
We're also collecting real ghosts to bring you. You believe in ghosts, don't you, Jill?
No.
You don't?
Not really.
Well, let me take you over here and convince you that they do exist.
When the Haunted Mansion finally did open its gates in 1969, that week was the highest attendance in Disneyland's history. It was a built-in marketing campaign because Walt had taken us on tours of it on television.
And Mark Davis is the master in charge of our House of Illusions, or what do we call it? A Haunted Mansion.
When Walt was around, he was able to meld Mark Davis and Claude Coates and Rolly Crump together and create something that was very harmonious. But as he departed, these people created in their own worlds. The Haunted Mansion is interesting because it depicts all three of those worlds. So I always like to think that the portions that are really creepy and scary belong to Claude Coates. The things that are strange and almost eerie and weird are definitely Rolly Crump. And the things, particularly in the end of the ride, that are humorous and fun belong to Mark Davis. And so you can really see the three personalities coming out in this ride.
Exitensio came in and threaded it all together. Okay, how do we take these rooms of illusions and give them a story? And he created the ghost house and created the script that carries you through. So he wrote those fantastic lines in the stretch room, you know, where he came up with, your cadaverous pallor betrays an aura of foreboding. I don't think we'll ever come up with that again, but it's classic.
Tomorrow offers new frontiers in science, adventure, and ideals. The atomic age, the challenge of outer space, and the hope for a peaceful and unified world.
Tomorrowland, a world of imagination and beyond, filled with science fiction fantasies and soaring space adventures. Minnie, so nice to see you. Hey, I've got a great idea. Why don't you and I take an out-of-this-world journey while the Imagineers tell us how they keep Tomorrowland from becoming Yesterdayland?
I think Tomorrowland was, from the beginning, the hardest land to do.
The biggest challenge when Walt Disney opened the park was Tomorrowland. So he assigned Ward Kimball to develop a series of television shows that would depict what it would be like when humans entered space.
Walt created a show, two shows, on space. One of the films was actually brought back to Washington.
President Eisenhower was so delighted with these films that he ran them for Congress, and he told Walt, he said, these did more to get the American public behind the space program than any of the bills before Congress.
Because Walt had a way of taking a very complicated topic and making it understandable for, you know, a mass audience.
It was an exciting and innocent time coming out of World War II. Freeways were new. The world on the move, as Walt called it, was something that we all dreamed about, getting behind the wheel of a car and being on the open roads.
Walt really loved the transportation stuff, and to have the train going through and the monorail, and originally in Disneyland, the Skyway and the jets and all of that, that was really wonderful action, you know, things happening. And I think we're getting back to that now. John Hench has been one of the huge influences in Tomorrowland. And John designed that original flight to the moon, which was, I still think, was one of the best theaters we ever built, because it was kind of wobbly to go into the theater. And you felt like you were going somewhere very special. You weren't on cement. You were on some kind of, like, an astronaut going, you know.
Walt Disney was such an amazing individual. He was fascinated with technology. He was fascinated with the future. He thought Disneyland could be a testing ground for new technologies. And so even though we think of the monorail and the People Mover as rides in the park, to Walt, they weren't rides. So he was always looking for ways that he could harness technology for entertainment.
The story goes that Walt was driving through a by road in Germany, and all of a sudden, this thing came out of the trees and streaked across the street. Got on the phone, he called Bob Gurr, and he says, I just saw a monorail go by. One of the great designers in Disneyland's history was Bob Gurr. And this is like 9 months before the opening of the submarine and the Matterhorn. He says, do you think we can have one of those in there by the time we open the other two rides? 9 months later, they had a monorail being opened by Vice President Richard Nixon at the time. Running in the park. It's been the first daily operating monorail in America from 1959 until today.
In 1959, Walt Disney introduced the Submarine Voyage, and it was one of the first e-ticket attractions, which, for those who don't know what an e-ticket is, an e-ticket was the most spectacular, the biggest, most elaborate shows in the park. And it was an instant success with a guest.
And there were 8 submarines built. They were amazing vehicles. They carried 38 passengers.
And Walt was very proud that he had the 8th largest submarine fleet in the world at that time. So it was treated like a real thing. And we had the Nautilus and the Skipjack and the George Washington. And it was a very authentic attraction.
You literally went into a submarine, looked through a porthole, through water, and went on this adventure underwater to the polar caps and
all the way to the North Pole, for crying out loud. I mean, how great is that?
You went to the lost continent of Atlantis.
And you saw all sorts of sharks and fish and undersea volcanoes and mermaids.
And sea serpents.
And it was fantastic.
So it became my new favorite.
It was a great part of Disneyland.
Well, Walt would get into everything he did, and while he was filming the movie, Third Man on the Mountain, he decided that the thing he had to have next at Disneyland was a copy of the Matterhorn. Now, the interesting thing about the ride that goes on and around the Matterhorn Mountain is it's the first tubular steel roller coaster built in America. But see, Walt Disney was never into using statistics like that. He was giving people a fabulous journey through the glacier grottos of the interior of the Matterhorn. That was all that was important to him. Not that it was the first steel coaster or it brought to life a whole new way of doing things. It was the Matterhorn Mountain.
He never stopped looking for ways where technology could serve the storytelling. But it was never technology for technology's sake. It was always technology to help bring the story to life in magical ways for our guests.
Now, the Matterhorn, aside from being the first tubular steel coaster in the world, also has kind of a neat myth about it, and that is up above where the ride runs, which is up to about two-thirds of the way, is an area that they didn't know what to do with. Maybe Walt gave the cast members a chance to come up with what would they do with this space. Anyway, it ended up being a basketball court. And when ride operators and the guys that climb the mountain are finished doing their work, they can go up there and shoot a few baskets high above everybody else that's going through the glaciers below.
Space Mountain is one of the classic, iconic Disneyland attractions. You can't imagine Tomorrowland without Space Mountain.
As so often happens, the technology wasn't available to do what we wanted to do in Space Mountain, which is put people in a dark environment and run those vehicles around. You couldn't keep them separated. Computer systems weren't sophisticated enough when John designed that originally in 1965. But by the early 70s, we were able to do it.
When Space Mountain opened at Disneyland in 1977, it was created with the special effects that the Imagineers knew how to create at that time. Well, a lot's changed in the world, and guests to our parks see amazing things in movies and television shows in terms of magic. So our Imagineers and our R&D division here at Imagineering had to come up with new magic. Space Mountain will have the fantastic ride that you remember, but what you see is going to be new and unique in many, many ways. Tony Baxter and I were the team on Star Tours, and he was the director and art director, and I was the writer and show producer. You know, to me, George Lucas was like Walt Disney. And to get to be an Imagineer and work for George Lucas, it was really amazing.
George had seen that one of the ways that Walt kept his characters alive was by putting them as real characters in the park. And George saw that and as a way of keeping his characters alive, R2-D2 and C-3PO. And so we had the opportunity to work with George in creating Star Tours.
Well, George Lucas was one of the first kids into Disneyland and went there as a child and loved Disneyland. So he was thrilled at the idea of bringing his property into the park. The question was, how would we do it?
You know, back in the mid-80s, when we were really searching for the next new thing, because these massive advancements were a part of what made Disneyland magical. And Randy Bright, head of our scripting and all of the films at that time, had been in England and visited a company that had what was a motion-based system that was used to train pilots. They were curious about, I wonder if this could be some kind of an attraction.
We saw the potential of allowing guests to physically be in the movie of Star Wars and have that sensation of being an X-Wing pilot and being able to live that fantasy in three dimensions, which is what our park's all about. So we rode the ride, we came back, we came up with a number of different ideas on what we could create as a storyline of that, met with George Lucas, he picked one, and off we went. Kids love games. It's a big part of the entertainment of their world. As Imagineers, our challenge is, how do we take that and interpret it in a Disneyland way? How do you step into a video game? Buzz Lightyear Astro Blasters is an Imagineering interpretation of putting you into a three-dimensional video game where you are helping Buzz Lightyear save the universe from the evil Emperor Zurg. I think Tomorrowland, when Walt first opened it, was trying to be more science factual. It was a time when the space program was just getting started, and there was incredible interest in the public in the future. Today, the world moves so fast, and things change so quickly. We're pushing more towards fantasy in our future.
Mickey, Minnie, so this is where you call home. Mickey's Toontown. You know, for years, Disneyland guests wondered where Mickey and his pals lived. In 1993, the gang decided to open the gates to the zany, wacky world of Toons. So let's see how the Imagineers spun this cartoon world off the animator's storyboard and into Disneyland.
Mickey's Toontown, and which came along with Joel and Cicero and others.
We We were given the assignment to create the land where Mickey Mouse lives, because one of the major complaints at Disneyland was, where do we meet Mickey? Where does Mickey live? So initially, our project just started out as the little neighborhood where Mickey and the characters lived. So of course, we knew we were going to have a house for Mickey and a house for Minnie, and we started to design all that. It's all about understanding the personality of the characters. And those Fab Five characters are very well defined. Everyone knows who Mickey is, and you know, Mickey's the leader, he's every man, you know, he's humble. And so we started talking about what kind of house would Mickey live in, you know, based on his personality. And I remember there were some debates about how grandiose it should be, because, you know, there were people within the company that felt that it should be a mansion-like house. And we said, no, that's not Mickey. Mickey is a humble guy. He's every man. You know, he grew out of Walt's imagination, and Walt was all about small-town America. And so this should be a reflection of Mickey and Walt. And right here in Southern California, in Pasadena, we have a style called bungalow, which is very interesting architecturally, but it's the overall feeling and appeal is its warmth. It's very warm and friendly. It's all of Mickey and Walt. Then we started thinking about Minnie, and not wanting to be stereotyped, you know, with little girls and frilly little, you know, gingerbread and all, but there was an expectation there. I mean, it was Minnie, and that's how she played in those films. This design certainly said feminine, certainly said Minnie, but there was a level of design sophistication to it that took it beyond a little dollhouse. I mean, in fact, if you study that house, there's a whole variety of architectural styles in there. But the overall effect is still feminine and sweet and Minnie. Then we got to Goofy's house. And I actually did the first design for Goofy's house because it was the easiest. And because Goofy is Goofy, you know? And the simplest thing was to make everything a little off-kilter, like Goofy. But one thing I started doing, playing with Goofy's house, that then kind of made its way to all the other houses, was the idea of color identification. Every one of those characters had a basic costume color scheme that people identified with them. Goofy with the green hat and the orange vest, and Mickey, of course, with the red pants and the yellow shoes, Minnie with the polka dot skirt. And so we picked up on those color schemes, and we actually started to look at physical things that we could do to the exterior of the houses, like Goofy's hat, that physically started making them look like the characters, but in a subliminal way. When you walked up to it, it just made logical sense. Oh, that's the house Goofy would live in. We knew we wanted to do another dark ride in Toontown. Another dark ride meant we need to do something different. Roger Rabbit is frenetic, so it was like, oh, this is perfect. We had the perfect ride vehicle from the movie, was Benny the Cab, a spinning cab going through Toontown. So to prove the concept, we went down to Disneyland after hours one night and was able to get them to take a teacup, real-life teacup, and we put it on the Pinocchio ride vehicle. And we took a little ride through Pinocchio just to see how it changed the dynamic of the experience. And on the surface, it was fun, but the thing that really stood out was all of a sudden, none of the vignetted moments were as important as the overall environment. So it immediately told us that we're going to have to take a different design approach to Roger Rabbit than the traditional dark rides, where you know, you move into a scene, there's a figure here, a backdrop there, and the track is usually configured to give you a view at those elements. All of a sudden, all bets were off where guests were going to be looking, because we were allowing them to spin 360 degrees.
Fantasyland is dedicated to the young and the young in heart, to those who believe that when you wish upon a star, your dreams do come true.
The most fantasy of all the Disneylands, Fantasyland is a festive storybook celebration of classic Disney animated stories and characters.
Probably the most signature thing that Walt would bring into Disneyland was the characters from his feature animation. Fantasyland became their home.
The heart of Disneyland is Fantasyland, and I think the symbol that more than anything, probably as much as Mickey Mouse, represents Disney is Sleeping Beauty's castle at the entrance to Fantasyland.
The castle was really influenced by one in Germany, the Neuschwanstein castle.
And if you saw the original pictures and drawings of the castle, you'd recognize the key architectural elements. And that's how it sat when it was converted into a model here at Imagineering. Herbie Ryman, who was assigned to drawing a picture of the castle, came by and looked at the model, and I think it disturbed him that it was such a copy of the original Neuschwanstein castle. And he thought he could do something better. So he was looking at the pieces of the model, looked at the backside, and he said, you know, that's actually more interesting than the front. So he took the top off, turned it around, and put it back down. Someone rushed over from the model shop and said, you know, Walt is gonna be here any second, put that back, don't mess with it.
And Walt came in and saw that the castle turned around.
And sure enough, the tap on the back, and Walt was saying, what's going on here? And Herbie says, well, I think it kind of looks better this way. And Walt looked at it and he said, yeah, I think you're right.
And he liked it better with the facade that was intended to be on the inside in the courtyard. So that's the way it was built originally.
And today, if you walk through Disneyland, go through the castle, turn around and look at it, you'll see Neuschwanstein, but it's on the back.
It was named Sleeping Beauty Castle because Walt was then in the middle of creating the movie, Sleeping Beauty.
Now, the interesting thing about it being Sleeping Beauty's castle is Disneyland opened 4 years before the movie Sleeping Beauty was to come to the theaters. Walt always had a lot of faith in his products.
The original Fantasyland had the Snow White Adventure and Peter Pan and Mr. Toad Wild Ride.
One of the most important and smallest rides in Disneyland's Fantasyland is Mr. Toad's Wild Ride. Now, the fun thing about Mr. Toad, it's a really out of control ride, and for some reason, it was decided we make a wrong turn near the end of the ride and somehow take a trip into Hades, and we find ourselves guilty of doing the wrong things and end up in a little scene that's in the Devil's Lair, which I was rather surprised for an opening day Disneyland story, but it's always been a guest favorite.
The carousel, beautiful carousel, that was actually purchased, but all the horses were redone so that, as John Hinch said, everyone rides to glory on a white stallion, you know. Originally, there was an area that was carved out called Storybook Land, but it was originally just a canal boat ride, and it wasn't called Storybook Land the first year because the little villages that are now part of Storybook Land, based on the settings from Disney feature animation, Pinocchio's Village and cottages of the dwarfs, etc., that wasn't finished. It's a Small World came out of the New York World's Fair, where Walt was approached by Robert Moses, who was the impresario of the fair, said, I've got Pepsi-Cola and UNICEF, and they want to do a show about the children of the world. And this was a year, just under a year before the fair opened. And Walt said, sure, let's do it. Well, everybody had to jump through hoops, of course, and that's how It's a Small World came about. And as soon as the fair was over, that was one of the key things that came back to Disneyland.
It is also here that we dreamed up the things for the World's Fair. And some of those things are coming back to Disneyland. And especially one that I'm in love with is the story of the children of the world. We call it It's a Small World. So over here, we're designing the facade for that thing when it does come back to Disneyland. I want you to meet Mary Blair. Mary,
hello,
this is Julie Reams.
Hello, Julie.
Mary Blair had been a great color stylist and an illustrator for many Disney films. Walt remembered her work and so asked her to come back and work on It's a Small World.
It's the most unique musical timepiece ever created.
The last attraction to be added to the roster for the New York World's Fair was It's a Small World. And what was unique about that was it was an opportunity to show the whole world coming together in kind of a brotherhood of children. And Walt's first thought was to have each group of children sing their national anthem or a national song, and it would be this wonderful kind of harmony as you went through. Well, harmony it was not. When they turned on all the speakers, it was a cacophony. And as he often did, he called Richard and Robert Sherman to come over and help out with this. And he says, you've got to fix it. You've got to come up with something that's simple, that brings the entire world together. And I think you can never underestimate how difficult it is to take all of that and kind of synthesize it down into something that brilliant. But they came back in relatively a week or so with the beginnings of It's a Small World After All. And when it was played against all of these different children, all singing with different dialects, the same lyrics, it became an American standard. And to this day is probably one of the most recorded songs in America, or the world for that matter. Now, going back to when we created the new Fantasyland from 1983, Disney hadn't created Little Mermaid or Beauty and the Beast or Lion King. So we were looking at the classics and we saw the obvious, and that was that there was no Pinocchio story. And it seemed right that we should honor that film with creating a new dark ride. So when we reopened Fantasyland, we had the originals. We had Alice in Wonderland and Snow White and Peter Pan and Mr. Toad, but we also added in a brand new ride, which was The Adventures of Pinocchio, which took us on that path between right and wrong as Pinocchio struggled to make the right decisions and went to Pleasure Island and got locked up with Stromboli and eventually found his way home to his father, and we had a magical effect with the Blue Fairy, and of course everything ends happily ever after.
Hey gang, I've had a great time taking you on this journey through more than 50 years of Imagineering magic. And what's the best way to end a day at Disneyland? Right, with parades and fireworks.
The future is a moving target. We have more exciting tools, and we get to use our imagination and how those tools become attractions in our parks.
As long as there is imagination left in the world, Disneyland will never be complete.